and which is this project named AppLab, this course named AppLab, which Geeks for Geeks has recently come up with. So it's basically based on the mobile app development. If you want to learn mobile application development, then this course is the one which is made for you. You can register yourself for this course. You have to visit this webpage where all the information related to this AppLab course you can find. The URL for accessing this web page, you can find it in the description section, right? And over here on this web page, you can find all the relevant information, right? So what are you going to learn in this course? So you will be learning about mobile applications, how you can design user interfaces for an application, then how you can make those user interfaces interactive by writing code, by adding code to the designing part, the design part. How can you create multi-screens applications? That's also what we will cover in this course. Now if you want to check out the topics, the syllabus that will be taught to you in this course, you can come down and that's the tab you can click on to check out the syllabus. So automatically a new tab will get open up on your browser where to which a PDF we have linked, and in this PDF file you can find all the topics that will be taught to you in the class, right? And besides these topics, there will be lot more things that we will be teaching you, and they're going to be a lot of fun. You are going to enjoy each and every class because we have put in a lot of effort in making this course and this curriculum. So if you want, you can avail this course, and the best part of this course is it is very affordable, right? So if you don't want to get yourself into this course, so at least you can refer this course to someone who requires it a lot, right? Now comes the point that if you do not want this course, then what else do we have for you? Suppose you are interested in artificial intelligence, machine learning, data science, or some bigger things like website development, or you want to learn PHP, WordPress, or Python, then Geeks for Geeks is into everything, right? We have the best tutors at our company who are ready to share the knowledge with you guys. Right now, if you want to check out the courses which you can avail, so you can visit Geeks for Geeks main website where you can find the details of every course that we provide, the lectures on which we provide. So go ahead, check out the website, avail the course that you like most, right? Okay, let's now come on Google and straight away dive into the platform. So today we are going to make rainy weather app, right, in Scratch. So the first thing we need to do is we need to access the Scratch platform. Okay, let me just tick mark this checkbox. So once you are done with writing this thing in the search box, automatically that's what you will be redirected to. Now here right on the top you can find the URL with which you can get yourself redirected on the Scratch environment. Now here you can click on this start creating button for accessing that virtual platform where you can create Scratch projects. And in between the lecture, I will be telling you some very interesting things, right? And also we are going to start up with a new project very soon, which I will discuss with you in between the lecture. So please don't skip any part, right? Watch this video till the end. Okay, and in case you have any issues, any queries, you can put them in the comment section. I will I'll keep on checking the comment section also. In case I find anything which needs to be answered, definitely I'll answer that query and I will resolve it. Okay, so once you are there on this platform, that's the sprite which you will be able to see. Now, in order to remove this sprite from here, you can simply click this bin button and it will go disappear, right? Now, the first thing we need to do is we need to define a beautiful background over here, right? On which the raindrops, the falling raindrops can look realistic. The app can look more realistic. So let's try to find out something on Google. I think we will be able to find some very good options on Google Images. So nature clip art. Okay, let's check out what can we find over here. Okay, so these are the options we can use. I think this is looking good, right? Let me see some more better option. Okay, so that is also a very amazing amazing image, right? It's looking interesting, but not that much appealing. How about this? But the water droplets are going to, this part of this image will hide the water droplets. I don't want that. Something which doesn't have blue color in it. Can we find anything over? Yeah, I think this is looking fine. Okay, we have many options available to us over here, but I want those droplets which I will be creating, I want them to be visible on the background. So that's the kind of background right now I am looking for, on which the droplets can be more visible to us. I think this is going to look amazing, right? So let's copy this image. Okay, and I am going to first paste it in the paint box, and thereafter I'll save it with a unique name on the desktop. But first of all, we have to eliminate this white space, which is visible to us over here. So for doing that, we can reduce the size of the window. Okay, and how to reduce it, or how you can zoom out, you can make use of these two options. So it is for zooming out and it is for zooming in. You just click on zoom out and the image will become more smaller. The size of this window as well as this image will become more small, just because we have zoomed out. And if you want to zoom in into this image, you can click on this button. Right, I am going to reduce the size of this window and make it equal to the size of this image so that the white portion can be eliminated. I think now it is looking perfectly fine. Once you are done with eliminating that white part, you can just save this image with a unique name on the desktop. For now, I am saving it with background. Right? Okay, I hope this much part is clear to every one of you. If you will keep on doing these things, if you'll follow these steps which I am doing right now, so it will be good for you. It will definitely give you a better understanding of this platform, right? Because until and unless you'll experience it practically, you will not be able to get a better idea of these things which I am showing you guys, right? Okay, so once you are done with saving the image on the desktop, you have to come on this Scratch platform. And now here you can go on that backdrops section. Now, how to go on that backdrops section? You can come over here, right in the bottom, you'll find this choose a backdrop option. So if you want to get yourself redirected to that backdrop library of Scratch, you can make use of this option. If you want to get yourself redirected to that environment where you can paint the backdrop yourself with different tools available in the backdrops library, so you can make use of this option. But for now, we want to import that image which we just saved on the desktop, right? And I want to see it on this playground over here. So for doing that, the best way is to make use of this upload backdrop option. Not the best way, this is the only way you can import the backdrop. You can import it as a sprite also, it totally depends upon you, but I would like to import it as a backdrop. So I'm clicking on this and it will redirect me to one of the locations present on my device. So that's where it has redirected me to. So it's my desktop. And let me just check out where I have saved that image. I am not able to see it over here. Let me see. I think I mistakenly have saved it somewhere else. Let me save it on my desktop. So background, and here I go. Now if I'll find it with B, yeah, that's the one I was looking for. Let's hit this open button. So automatically it will get imported and we will be able to see it getting reflected on the playground like this. Now if you want to play with the dimensions of this image, because still it is not covering this entire playground area. So what we have to do, we will have to increase the length and width of this image. For doing that, we can simply first convert it into vector form. Right now it is in bitmap form, and for bitmap images, those select and the options with the help of which we can control the dimensions. Those options are not available for the bitmap images, but if you'll convert it into vector, so you will be able to see those options getting visible over here in this part, in this toolbox over here. Right now, if you want to see those tools, you can convert it into vector form. How you'll do that? You just have to click on this button and automatically this platform will convert this bitmap image into the vector form. Now these are the two options I was talking about. So that's the select option, with the help of which you can select it and drag and drop it anywhere, and you can move it anywhere on this empty frame. Then we have this option. The name of this option is reshape option. If you want to reshape this image, you can do it with the help of this tool. So for now I'm making use of this selection tool. So as soon as after selecting the selection tool, you'll click on this. So automatically these blue lines, this blue rectangle, you'll be able to see, and these dots also you will be able to see getting reflected on this blue rectangle. Now I would like to enlarge it. Let me just change the width and height of this image, and I would like to change it in such a way that it can cover the entire this playground. Okay, so I think we are almost done with that. Yeah, now see how beautiful this image is looking. It's covering the entire playground area. There is some white space which is visible to us right in the bottom. Let me cover that too. So it's very easy. We have to just drag it and increase the height of this. I think now it is perfectly fine. Yes, it is good to go. Okay, so we are done with defining a playground. We are done with defining a beautiful image on this playground. Let's come on this coding section. Now the second thing that we need is, because we are creating a rainy weather. We are here for creating a rainy weather. So we want some rain droplets. From where can we get it? Either we can paint it ourselves using the paintbrush tool, or the tools available in the that costumes library. or else we can just try to search for some relevant image in the sprites library of Scratch. Let's first go with the later option. Let's first go with the second option, and in case we don't find any relevant sprite in the sprites library of Scratch, we are going to paint the sprite ourselves. Okay, so that's where it will redirect you to. Now here, let me just see if I can get a relevant option, and let me just type rain over here. No, it's not giving me the. And how about diamond? Okay, cone. No, we are not getting anything which is relevant. Animals, dance, music. So sprites related to all these categories you can find over here. Let me just check in this letters. Okay, no, these will not work. And how about fantasy? I think that's the one which is looking somewhat relevant. You know, the second costume of this sprite is looking very much like a raindrop. Let's use this one. Let's try this one. So we can just click on this to bring it on the playground, and that's how it is going to look like. Now let's come on this costume section, and I don't want to use this first one. It's not looking like as if it is a rain droplet. I think that's the one we can make use of, right? It's right now, you know, its color is blue. So we will have to change its color. Let's change it to blue. Of course, we will have to change it to blue. How about this color? I think that's looking perfectly fine. Let me reduce the size of this. Okay, would like to eliminate this line from here. Yep, now it is looking like a raindrop to me. Yep, perfectly fine. I think this much size is good to go. Now we need to come back on this coding section. So till now, what all things we have discussed, let me tell you that. What all things we have done, let me tell you that. So the first thing we did was we finded out this beautiful image on Google Images. We saved it with a unique name on our device, and then we imported on this beautiful playground, right? And after that, we went to the sprites library of Scratch, from where we picked up this sprite. It's looking like as if it is a raindrop, which we really want for this game. Now we are going to define the code for this raindrop sprite. Okay, so let's begin with the coding part. So the first thing we need to do is we need to come on the events section, and from here we can pick up this when the flag is clicked block. We can put it over here. Now I would like to repeat some code for a certain number of times. So for that, I think repeat block is going to be a good option if you'll use it. Yes, so repeat this code for the 100 times. The one which I am going to put over here inside this repeat block, that's what I want. So we need to come on this motion section, and from here we can pick up this go to X block. I am putting it over here, right? Now what? Now as soon as you'll hit this button, hit this flag button, so nothing is going to happen because it's already at this position. This droplet is already at this position, which we have defined over here in this go to X block. Now what we can do, we can come down in this operator section, and I would like to define a random position, random X position for this droplet. So we can, I think, make use of this block, and we can simply put it over here. And as you know, the dimensions of this playground along X axis, if you'll consider X axis, then here it is -240 and here it is 240. So it extends from -240 to 240, right? So we can make use of these two numbers, -240 and 240, so that we can see the drops covering the whole playground. That is the reason I have given these two values over here. Then along with this, let's do one thing. Let's set the size also. So I would like to see some droplets of small size, some of bigger size, and you know, there should be a size difference also in between the droplets. So for doing that, the best way we can do it is with the help of, I think, the set size block we can use it. Yes, so set size we can find, I think, over here in this coding section. Where is that set size? Yeah, that's the one I was looking for. So I'm putting it over here. Now if you want to set the size or set a random size for each and every droplet, we can make use of this pick random and pick up random value from 20 to 40%. Okay, now if you'll hit this flag, so see, we are able to see it moving, but only there is only one droplet, and it's moving along the x-axis. It's not going, it's not coming from up, and it's not moving along the y-axis. Instead of that, it is moving along the x-axis. We'll rectify it, don't worry about that. But I hope you are able to understand this code over here. If not, then please do let me know in the comment box. Now before moving to the next part, I would like to show you something, lectures on which we are going to give you guys from the next week. So that's the platform, Tinkercad. Okay, so now from the next week, I'll give you the lectures on this Tinkercad platform. So if you do not know about this, let me tell you guys what all things you can do on this beautiful Tinkercad platform. So basically, it's a platform, it's an open source online platform which provides us with a virtual environment where we can create circuits, we can learn about circuits, electronic circuits related things, and we can learn about electronics, we can design circuits, we can make use of block based coding for coding the circuits, we can make use of, you know, it also provides us with a platform on which we can make 3D models, right? So all those things we will be covering in the tutorials that I will be providing to you guys from the next week, right? So from the next week, we are going to have the tutorials on this platform. So make sure you have created your account on this platform, and you have the access to your dashboard, to your respective dashboard on this platform. In case you come across any issue while creating the account, you can tell me in the comment section in tomorrow's video. Definitely I will try to sort it out right in the end or in the beginning of the lecture, so that when I will be taking the very first project on this platform, you will be able to get a good understanding of the basic things that we will cover with that project, right? Okay, let's move to the Scratch platform. So we are done with defining this much of code. Now, I want to see number of droplets over here. Right now, there is only one droplet. How can I create a copy? How can I create several copies of this droplet? So for that, we can make use of create clone block, right? So you can find it over here, I think. I'm looking for cloning. Yes, that's the one I was searching for. So create clone of myself. As soon as the flag will be clicked, now what will happen? Let me show you that. So now, as you can see, we are the clones of these droplets have got created, and there are 100 copies which this platform has created of that droplet, right? Why? Because it's 100 which we have mentioned over here in this repeat block. Okay, now when the clone, when it start as a clone, then what should happen? Let's define the code for the same. So that's the last section of this tutorial. right? And this is where you will learn to do the magical thing that I wanted to show you right from the beginning. So here I go. So when I start as a clone, then what should happen? I would like to you make use of this gliding block. So glide from, not this one, sorry, not the random position. I would like to make use of this one where we have the facility of defining the parameters, the values for both these things, X and Y, right? So for this X, I would like to have a random value. We can make use of pick random block. We can put it over here. And I would like to have a random value in between 2 and 4. I think that's going to be a good option. Okay, not here. I think here it will be better, right? Because there should be a time gap, no, in between the creation of the clone. Then after this, for this X and Y, for this X, let's make use of this X position. If you don't know why I'm using this X position, please do check out the previous tutorials which I have published on Geeks for Geek School. Definitely you will be able to understand why we have put this X position over here. And over here you can make use of this value -200, because this platform extends from -240 to 240 in positive, right? Positive 240. Then we need to define an if control statement. So that's how we can, from this section, we can easily find this if then statement, if then control statement over here, and we can just drag it and drop it over here. If at any point of time these droplets touches these edges, then what should happen? Now that's what I would like to define the code for. So let's make use of this touching block, and from this drop down let's select edge. So if any of these droplets will touch these edges of the playground, what will happen? I would like them to go hidden, or they should disappear, right? So that's the code. Let's now check out what's the output we will get when we will run this code that we have defined over here in this coding workspace, right? So I'm going to test it on a bigger window so that we can actually enjoy the rainfall. So you know, that's what we are getting as an output right now. So the rain droplets are coming from this point. They are not coming from the top. Why is it so? Let me just check it. So pick random, okay, set size to, why it's not coming from the top? It's just because here I have defined -40, right? And it should be, I think it should be +180, because you know, along y-axis the platform extends from -180 to 180. It goes from -180 to 180. So 180 is the topmost point. So that's the reason I've defined 180 over here. If you want, you can define 200 also. It's totally your call. Now when you will run this game, so that's what the output you will get. So it's like, you know, the rainfall. Okay, so now the rain has stopped just because that repeat block has created for us all the 100 sprites. It created for us all the 100 sprites successfully. Now let's see if we'll replace this repeat block with forever, and we'll put all these three blocks inside that forever block. So then what is the output we'll get? So let's check it out. So I'm removing this repeat block from here, and let's put this forever block, and let's put all these blocks over here inside it. Now I'm running the game. So rainfall has started and the clones are getting created, and rain, it's not stopping, you know, it's a continuous rainfall which we are able to see over here, right? So you know, that's what the output you will get. It will go on creating the clones forever till you stop the game. So for now I'm stopping it. Okay, Okay, so I think we are done with this. We are done with making this beautiful rainy weather app. So that's the code which I have used right for this rain droplet. Okay, if you want, I can just zoom in so that the code can be more visible to you guys. That's the code. Now, before ending this lecture, I would like to again tell you about the App Lab course which we have come up with. So this course is based upon mobile app development. If you want to learn how you can develop mobile apps at App Lab, then this course is made for you. So for checking out the information related to this course, you can visit this page. If you want to get the link of this page, you can check out the description section of this video that you're watching right now. So in that you will find the link of this web page where you'll get all the information related to this course which Geeks has come up with recently. And also, if you want to check out the syllabus and the topics that will be covered in this course, you can just click on this button which will redirect you on a new tab where we have connected a PDF file in which you'll find all the topics that will be covered in the online classes which will be given in the course to the students. Right, so these are all the topics, and besides these topics there are lot many things that will be covered. Right, so if you want, please go ahead and avail the course. And let me tell you one more thing, this course is, it's a limited offer, right? Because we are providing this course in a very, very, very affordable price. If you want to know more about this course, definitely you can contact our executive team. You can get our toll-free number from our main website. Okay, or you can sign in into this app. Our executive team, one of our executive members will contact you, will get in touch with you, and you can, ask him whatever queries you have related to this course or some other course which you want to pursue. Because Geeks for Geeks is into everything. We are into data science, we are into artificial intelligence, we are doing machine learning, we are doing website development, we are into PHP plus WordPress. We give free of cost webinars also. If you want to conduct webinars, if you want us to conduct webinars in your schools, please let us know. Right, please let your teachers also know about what Geeks for Geeks is providing to the kids. Right, okay, so that's it from my side in this lecture. Hope you guys enjoyed this lecture a lot. Thank you very much all of you for joining me in this tutorial. Have a great day ahead. Bye bye everyone.